this time I'll read both parts for us. Matthew chapter 13, verses 24 through 30 and 36 through 43. He put before them another parable. The kingdom of heaven may be compared to someone who sowed good seed in his field. But while everybody was asleep, an enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and then went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared as well. And the slaves of the householder came and said to him, "Master, did you not sow good seeds in your field? Where then did these weeds come from?" He answered, "An enemy has done this." The slaves said to him, "Then do you want us to go and gather them?" But he replied, "No, for in gathering the weeds, you would uproot the wheat along with them. Let both of them grow together until the harvest. And at harvest time, I'll tell the reapers, collect the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into my barn." Then he left the crowds and went into the house. And his disciples approached him, saying, "Explain to us the parable of the weeds of the field." He answered, "The one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and the good seed are the children of the kingdom. The weeds are the children of the evil one, and the enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the reapers are angels. Just as the weeds are collected and burned up with fire, so will it be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will collect out of his kingdom all causes of sin and all evildoers. And they will throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Let anyone with ears listen." This ends our reading. Please join me in prayer. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing to you, O God, our Rock, our Redeemer. Again, Jesus says, "Let anyone with ears listen." Last week, we read the parable of the sower casting seeds on the path, the rocky soil, among thorns, and on the well-prepared, fertile soil. This week, we have another agricultural illustration of God's way. Things are going pretty well on the farm. The soil is rich. It's been worked to be ready for the crops to do well. There's plenty of help to take care of the fields throughout the growing and harvesting season. But there is an enemy who sneaks in when everybody is sleeping and scatters weed seeds among the good seeds. So when the plants sprout, the field is filled with both wheat and weeds. The owner did a surprising thing. In my experience, the sooner you get weeds pulled, the easier it is to dislodge them from the soil. Let them get a foothold and their roots spread, making it harder to pull them. Plus, they take the vital nutrients from the soil that the plants need, and they consume the water too. The owner had a different way of seeing things. He told the workers not to pull the weeds. Chances are, in the process of pulling weeds, some of the good plants would also be destroyed. And the farmer wasn't willing to lose a single wheat plant. So the weeds got the same opportunities as the plants, growing side by side in that carefully tended space. But we know that when Jesus tells a parable, the obvious point of the story is never the real point of the story. For me, this week, reading this scripture, this was another way of talking about who belongs and who has a right to live. We humans are very good at making this distinction. We are quick to categorize people into classifications of plants and weeds. During World War II, it was us versus the Germans, Italians, and Japanese. We divided so well that families in this country felt pressured to change their last names so nobody would know their ancestry. We even extended our animosity to dogs. I've heard that German shepherds and dachshunds were killed because they were breeds that originated in Germany. Soon, the Cold War developed, and it became okay to be German, Italian, or Japanese, but not good to be Russian or Chinese. We had to be on our guard against the evil communist horde. Now, it's people who are not Christian. We don't trust anyone who is Muslim. Our distrust of Muslims is so widespread that we include Hindus in it. After all, they wear some kind of funny hats on their heads too. So they must be part of that group that we don't understand and we refuse to get to know and we just want nothing to do with because they're different from us. But Jesus had a different idea. He says, let them go together where they can influence each other, where bad people can become good people. And maybe some of the good people will turn into bad people, but at least they will have all had a chance to live and grow and develop into the people God created them to be. It isn't just people of other politics that we classify as weeds, or people of other religions. When the Europeans immigrated to this land, there were already people living here, but they were different. So they had to be conformed to European ways of living or be destroyed. Then came the next people to be judged, the forced immigrants from Africa, the people who were bought and sold like livestock, because after all, they were different from us and must not be of the same value as white humans. And now we have a third type of immigrant that is being judged as weeds. Many people would like to eradicate the immigrants who are risking their lives to come here without the proper documentation in search of safety, food, and shelter. Complicating the discussion of illegal immigration, now desperate people are sending their little children here without them in the hope that the children will find humanitarian aid and a better life. We had an interesting discussion about these undocumented children at Bible study this week. Those of us who spoke up first talked about the desperation of the parents and their heartache at sending their children off alone. We wanted those children to be scooped up and placed in safe, loving homes where they could grow and be nurtured into the people their birth parents know that they would be. But one person, who I won't name because I didn't ask permission to discuss that person's politics, suggested that tighter borders would be a good place to start. With closed borders, we would not have the problem we now have of unaccompanied minors appearing in desperate need. We wouldn't have the decision of whether to keep them and thereby increase the numbers of children being sent alone or to repatriate them. Repatriating them, after all, seems to be such a cold and heartless solution to our problem without addressing the problems that caused the parents to send them away. But the Bible study person had thought of that, too. With no undocumented immigration to manage, we could then focus our humanitarian efforts on helping the parents be able to keep their children. We could pressure their governments to change. We could address the real problem, unsafe living conditions for entire populations. We could improve the lives of all those people so no parent is so desperate that they are willing to face the agony of sending their dream child off to a strange land alone. We won't pretend to know the solution to the problem of undocumented immigration. What I do know is the solution won't be found if we persist in a weeds versus plants mindset. Eliminating weeds is a dangerous thing to do. Like the owner in our parable said, lots of plants can be lost in the process. I know, because I've destroyed my share of plants in my limited gardening experience. I have lilies. Newly sprouted lilies take one of two forms. Daylilies look a lot like grass, which does not belong Asiatics look a lot like some other kind of weed that also doesn't belong. You have to let them grow to know which is which. Several years ago, I started noticing a really pretty flower in yards and public gardens. It was an interesting shade of pinkish purple. I asked around and found out they were purple cone flowers. I decided I wanted some in my flower bed, but I'm too cheap to buy well-established pots of plants, so I purchased seed. I read and followed the directions, but nothing happened. All I got was a bunch of leaves. Not a single plant came up from that entire packet of seed. Undaunted, I bought more seed the next year. There must have been something wrong with that previous package that kept it from germinating. Or maybe I didn't water it well enough. So, determined to get my home flowers, I watered faithfully and kept on top of all the weeds that were popping up in my flower bed. In spite of my best efforts, another season passed with still no home flowers. The next spring, I was walking past one of the flower beds that I had so admired in downtown Jackson, and I noticed the tiny plants starting to pop up. They looked strangely familiar. They looked just like the leaves I had so carefully been pulling so that my much-coveted cornflowers wouldn't have to compete for space when they finally started growing. Turns out, the reason I never got the flowers I wanted was because I failed to recognize them as babies. I was so protective of my potential unborn plants that I was unknowingly eliminating them before they had a chance to develop. It was a silly mistake to make, since I had watched other plants transform from their initial appearance into a very different adult plant. But it was also a very valuable lesson. Not just a gardening lesson, but a life lesson. First impressions can be completely wrong. Be quick to judge and result in bad judgments. It's better to wait to see what the true nature turns out to be. Just like the snap judgments made as a society regarding Native Americans or people with ancestry from whatever country we're now politically separating ourselves from, or people with certain skin colors, or tattoos and piercings, or wild colored hair, or too heavy or too thin, we can judge incorrectly and eliminate the potential for great beauty in our lives. Jesus said to let all the plants grow together. It's not easy to resist the temptation to eliminate what is different. It is much easier to create us and them categories and boundaries. As an ethnically blended family, I can tell you there is much to be gained by blurring those distinctions. Two of my brothers married Asian women. Because of those relationships, we had new traditions in our family and new ways of appreciating each other. We borrowed from other cultures and enriched our own lives by letting the different become part of us. The wives changed and became more like European Americans. But we changed too. Living side by side, growing together, we are a much more beautiful garden than we would have been without them. As followers of Christ, we're called to nurture each other. We're called to recognize each other as valuable. We're called to leave the judgmental separation up to the angels who will do that job when it's time. We're called to live together, growing, side by side. May we be always on the lookout for weeds, so that when we spot one, we can adjust our own thinking, allowing us to recognize a brother